Let us pray. Let them grace thee. The memory of your
renown is in the fifth code. Thou, O Lord, shall protect us and preserve us from this generation forever.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. writings of the Holy Apostle Evangelist Mark.
May God, through the prayers of Holy, Glorious, and Honorable Apostle Evangelist Mark, enable you to proclaim the glad tidings with great power to the fulfillment of the gospel of his beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Wisdom, let us attend, let us listen to the Holy Gospel. Gospel according to Saint Mark.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory
to thee. Let's attend.
At that time, Jesus entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately, many gathered together, so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door, and he preached the word to them. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, "Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" But immediately, when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, "Why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven you,' or to say, 'Arise, take up your bed, and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house." And immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw anything like this." The Lord said, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I have come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And the other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd."
As your alarm clock, to be here today with this ridiculous time change that we have to do. But in any case, last week we proclaimed at the end of our procession with the icons that we worship God, that we offer God due worship, God alone, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that we offer Him this worship, this attentiveness that we give to Him alone, and that we reverence the saints, including, of course, the Mother of God as the Saint of the Saints, and all the saints who have shone forth throughout history. But it is God alone whom we worship, and we have been created by Him for that purpose, for the purpose of worshiping God. And that may sound like it's selfish, that God would create someone or something just so that it can worship Him. But what does the word worship mean? It means to offer adoration. It means to offer reverence. It ultimately means to offer love. That God, in the abundance of His love, God is love in a way that we cannot even understand love. That out of that love, and in a desire to share that love, He has created us in His image in hopes that we would return that love to Him, that same adoration, that same response of love to Him. Worship is not in the context of fearing or doing something that we can earn a reward. In the Christian context, the Orthodox context, it is adoration, it is love, it is a return, a sign of return of love to God, the same love, a portion of the love, if you will, that He has given to us, as He has granted us life and given us life and sustains us in our life. But what happens, what do we do when we're not worshiping God? And if you look on your bulletin, I put a quote here, not from an Orthodox saint, but from someone who some of you may have remembered, Archbishop Fulton Sheen, who had a radio show, was a Roman Catholic archbishop, and was very orthodox in his teachings. And he said, if you do not worship God, you worship something. And 9 times out of 10, it will be yourself. You have a duty to worship God, not because He will be imperfect and unhappy if you do not, but because you will be imperfect and unhappy. That if we not enter into the worship of God, we first find ourselves worshiping something else. So for example, when we go to confession and we say, it's difficult for me to pray, or I find myself falling into this sin or that sin, or I find myself unable to be attentive during the services, or I find myself unable to fast, to read the scriptures, to enter into anything that would be this return of adoration to God. These beautiful ascetical tools the church has given us, that if we're not doing those things, and when we deliberately do not do those things, including loving our neighbor, we're worshiping ourselves. We're putting our own needs, our own desires above that which God has created us to do, and that is to love Him and to love our neighbor as ourself. To enter into this relationship of love and to cultivate it. It's also been said that if we're not worshiping God, we're worshiping our own minds, right? The God of our own minds. That we enter into what we feel fasting should be, or we feel God is, or who He is, or who she is, or whatever the definition people may run with. That this is what I'm comfortable with, this is what I'm going to create in my mind, therefore I have comfort in it. And we create a God of our own mind, and ultimately we're only pursuing that which we've created in our mind, and that is going to lead us to a place that's probably not where God is. That 9 times out of 10, we worship ourselves, our own desires, our own thoughts, our own justifications, our own will, that is what we pursue instead of offering adoration and reverence to Almighty God in the smallest of ways, but yet the most profound ways of sacrifice, of fasting, sacrifice of love, to love and serve others, to cultivate the virtues, to ultimately answer and embrace our high calling to become more like the Son of God, to become more like Jesus Christ, to pursue that perfection of love. This is our calling, brothers and sisters. We don't worship God because we're afraid that if we don't do it, He'll destroy us. If we have that mindset, we need to push that out of our brains right now, because that's not what worship is in the Orthodox Church. Saint Gregory Palamas, who we commemorate today, great saint of the church, also speaks to this idea of worship, and he brings us to a point that we have to recall what happens in the Old Testament worship, where you'd offer a sacrifice of an animal, you'd bring it to the temple, the priest would slaughter it, the priest would take the choice parts of that animal, not the intestines and not the sort of throwaway scraps, and take those choice parts and roast them at the altar, and that fragrance would go up and the smoke would go up to God, and if the smoke went straight up, God heard your prayers. If it went sideways or whatever, you had to bring another animal and try again. But there's this idea of our worship of God being a fragrant offering to Him. That if the worship is true, and the worship is something that is in spirit and truth, that it'll be well-pleasing to God. But St. Gregory talks about a little bit something different. He says, if you put something fragrant to burning coals, you motivate those who approach to come back again and to stay near. But if instead you put on something with an unpleasant, oppressive smell, you repel them and drive them away. It is the same with the mind. If your attention is occupied with what is holy, and make yourself worthy of being visited by God, since this is the sweet savor which God catches scent of. On the other hand, if you nurture evil, foul, and earthly thoughts within you, you remove yourself from God's supervision, and unfortunately make yourself worthy of His aversion. That if we end up in our minds and our hearts worshiping ourselves and putting those things selfishly before God, that our desires, our passions, our thoughts, if we do that, it stinks. It smells. It's something God doesn't want to smell. It'd be like me coming out with the censer and putting on some really terrible smelling incense on it. We would never do that. You may not like the scent that we're using. I get opinions about that. But we don't put anything foul on it. We don't want to drive people away by that smell. And as we enter into, or try to enter into, a true and daily worship of God, mind, soul, spirit, our hearts, that we try to focus that worship on God, and we try to fast, pray, be kind to our neighbors, all the things, read the gospel, read the scriptures, of course, come to liturgy, come to the worship of the church, all these things that we do to cultivate that relationship, if we do them with a right mindset, and this is well-pleasing to God. It's a fragrant odor that He accepts. But if we enter into, as Archbishop Fulton says, the worship of ourselves, and put God behind us, and put our own needs and desires and passions in front of us and pursue those, then we end up worshiping ourselves, and St. Gregory says, it'll lead to an aversion, it'll lead to God avoiding us. God not wanting to be around us. Brothers and sisters, this time of Lent is that time to return to God and to offer a pleasing sacrifice to Him. a pleasing worship to him, to re sort of inventory and re-examine what is it that I spend most of my time on? What is it that has most of my attention? But yet I have this striving and desire to be with God. I love God. But yet these things get in the way. And then we can sit and we can pray and we can examine our conscience and say, what is getting in the way? What are those things that I worship in place of worship of God? Is it my own justifications? Is it my own desires? Is it my own sinful passions? Or is it something else? Is it the worship of indifference? The worship of apathy? The worship of being sort of lukewarm with God? Let us rouse ourselves, brothers and sisters, and offer unto God a sweet-smelling sacrifice, one where we offer to him that reverence, that adoration, out of love, not out of fear, out of love, that we may cultivate that relationship with him, that he may bless our intentions, he will receive what we are offering ourselves as a whole burnt offering to him, that he'll accept that, that he'll bless that intention, and he'll return upon us the grace of his Holy Spirit to further strengthen us and to further equip us to worship him even more and to enter more into a deeper relationship of love with him and with one another. And may we do this through the intercessions of Saint Gregory Palamas and of all the saints. Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy on us and save us. Amen. Christ is in our midst.
Megan, Anna, Sean, Alice, Melinda, Brie, Liz, Aunt Khalil, Allison, Magdalene, Terry, Jamie,
the suffering whom we are praying for this day, together with those who have fallen asleep in hope of eternal rest. May the Lord God remember them in his kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. President of this nation and civil authorities, those serving in its armed forces, especially those serving in harm's way, may the Lord God remember them in his kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. For you and all Orthodox Christians, may the Lord God remember you in his kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Thank you.
Holy, holy,
especially for our most holy, most pure, most blessed, and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary.
Spirit, let us
Let us worthily give thanks unto the Lord.
Thank you.
Christ, our King immortal, and our God.
Christ is
in our midst.
Good
morning, everyone. A few real brief announcements. Just reminders tonight, Vespers for the Deanery Vespers is in Kenosha, Wisconsin at St. Nicholas Church, beginning at 6 p.m. And then on Wednesday, we'll continue with our joint pre-sanctified liturgies. This Wednesday will be at St. Luke Church in Palos Hills. That's also at 6 p.m. A meal follows each of those services, as well as a small sermon at the end of the service. Wonderful opportunity to see everybody, see people throughout the deanery and our local parishes as well, our sister parishes. So please note that, and everything else, I think you can read up. And we'll sing many years. Christ is in our midst.
Grant, O Lord, a prosperous and peaceful life, and salvation forever and all good things. Unto thy servants, ushering the purchase, to speak Olivia, Thomas, Charles, and Lillian, and preserve them, O Lord, for many blessed years.
Christ is in our midst.
Yes. Yes. Yes.